So I wanted to know, why did you decide to put a film together?
Well, I was invited to give a lecture on the early history, and rather than having one voice, when there were truly so many people involved, and especially because we've lost key people like Merle Sandy, I wanted to try to capture this moment and to allow other people to tell the story.
Well, I arrived in San Francisco in 1973. I was 17, and like so many of the other young gay men, I was fleeing, you know, really repressive hometown. In my case, it was Phoenix. And San Francisco at the time was a very romantic place. The hippie era was just ending, and the gay revolution was beginning. And it was very exciting. It was very sexually charged. People were very idealistic. It was a sort of revolutionary feeling about the place. And people were able to be free for the first time. People were also very conscious of the political implications of what we were doing. And particularly after Harvey Milk and George Moscone were killed, you know, it was a profound political shift in the city. And so, despite the tragedies of the murder, gay people felt powerful. And so there was this great optimism, despite the tragedy of losing these two great men.
And almost at that very moment, the virus was coming into the city.
Yes.
The MMW report was the first that I heard of it. And to tell you the truth, I didn't really expect that this was, I mean, I don't think anyone expected it was going to be what it is today. And it wasn't until many physicians in San Francisco and Los Angeles and New York and around the country started calling to their health department saying, wait a minute, I saw somebody like that. I didn't know what I was dealing with. I think I have a case that's similar to what was in the MMWR. And then, of course, that's when our infectious disease, our epidemiological section of the health department started getting into gear on this.
You know, when I was a surgical resident, it was a macho thing. You know, we were on the trauma service and we would come out of the operating room covered in blood. And that was a sign that you had made your bones.
Badge of courage.
And that was a badge of courage that you were a real surgeon. And of course, after HIV, all that had to go away. And basically, we had to change our way of thinking. So what we started doing is, you know, wearing water protective footwear with my big rubber boots up to the knees, urology aprons, so because the gowns were not water impermeable. Double sleeves, because sometimes the fluid would seep through to your arms, and double gloves. And my idea is we should do that for everybody, because we didn't know who was infected and who wasn't at that time.
There was a famous disco star I took care of when I was an intern who was just hilarious. And I loved him, and I loved everything about him. And I had to go into his room fully gowned and gloved. And I do remember talking to Nick and my other fellow interns about that big challenge of connecting to patients and feeling like you weren't afraid of the patient and yet protecting yourself. And how it just never matched up well for any of us. It was hard.
There was a period where Molly and I were both so afraid that we had to agree not to talk about it to each other. I had recurring nightmares that I had given it to my kids. And it was just, we were having our family at the time, and it was so frightening, we just couldn't even talk about it.
Our first child, Alex, he had on his ear a little red mark that anybody else, any grandmother in Iowa would have said, that's just a stork bite. But I remember looking at that saying, could that be Kaposi's?
Connie's attitude toward that was interesting and was educational for me. She saw the unusual time as the time where doctors weren't at risk, and she saw it as part of the history of medicine to take care of patients even if it put you at risk. That was part of the profession.
Wasn't feeling well today. Got up late and missed going to the concert with Randy and Doug.
The patients were exactly our age, almost strangely. All those other ways that we tend to separate ourselves meant very little when you realize that the patients had gone to the same schools that you did, they listened to the same music, they went to the same restaurants, so they were really us. So it made it impossible to really separate oneself, which added to the commitment that I think all of us had, but it clearly added to the stress of it as well.
I was terrified. I had nightmares every night for months. It was so terrifying, and then it was like an avalanche. I mean, it still takes my breath away to think about how suddenly and swiftly it just, all of a sudden, everybody was dying.
Right.
I could still tell you a story about almost every building on those three blocks of Castro Street. You know, this is where Frank died, this is where John died, this is where Billy died, this is where Henry was evicted when they found out, and this is where they found George 6 weeks after he died because no one was looking after him.
You could be on call one night and covering for two or three other residents as they signed out. One of their patients would die, another one would die. You'd admit somebody, they would die. The course of a night on call, people you didn't know, you were just covering for them, calling a loved one, and it was really quite extraordinary.
Yeah, I look back at those days and, you know, if you weren't doing something, you lived in San Francisco, and, you know, certainly if you were a gay man, but actually almost anybody, seeing this suffering on the streets, the Kaposi sarcoma, the lesions all over people's faces, if you saw all that, how could you not do something?
San Francisco as a community developed the San Francisco model, as we called it.
When you use that term, what are the elements of it then?
I guess it's the elements of the larger community of gay men and women, because gay women became very involved in supporting the medical and political response to the epidemic. And, you know, we saw it at San Francisco General on our inpatient ward with people coming on the weekends and serving food to the inpatients, entertaining them, giving them gifts. I remember one of the gay organizations used to bring little packets of toiletries and bathrobes and slippers so that people didn't have to wear hospital gowns. And it was, and the development of the hospice, Coming Home Hospice, where my partner died, is right across the street from Most Holy Redeemer, which is the church in the Castro, the gay community. And they developed this place where I always said they did God's work because, you know, the way the staff there cared for these patients with end-stage HIV/AIDS was pretty heart-wrenching.
A while after my brother died, and I had taken care of a lot of patients at that point in the city and had gone to a lot of services, there was a small support group that got together of women, Latina women, who had lost their gay brother. And that was a group of 15 of us. So there were, you know, formations happened around the loss of a whole generation of men, principally men, not exclusively, but principally. And those formulations were also beautiful formulations because they would have never happened without what we were sharing was a loss. We describe it as a model, but I think part of it was we were in the midst of an epidemic that touched every part of the fabric of our community. And all of the inclination of the fabric was to do something.
There was something for everybody to do. The lawyers formed a group to help with legal matters. Some people would come into a house and clean the house. And some Project Inform, you know, was born around this time that helped people understand the medications and work with them. The hotlines were formed. Ruth Brinker had started this amazing organization called Project Open Hand. Her vision was meals with love for persons with AIDS. And she started in her own kitchen feeding 7 men who had AIDS. You know, Project Open Hand started here, but there are now like 125 around this country, and there's some in South Africa. It all started here, in Ruth Brinker's vision.
I remember the clinic marched in the parade, in the Gay Freedom Day parade, and I still have a picture of the clinic staff, me among them, holding a banner from the AIDS clinic in the parade and thinking, boy, I've come a long way from my little Catholic school in Nevada to march in the parade. And how great it was to see how much the community was involved in the patient care, but also how supported we felt in the clinic, because it was so overwhelming how sick the patients were and the need for social services and home care, that there really was enormous support and camaraderie, that we were all in this together.
Going to a meeting at the Valencia Rose tonight. I can't believe the city is thinking about shutting down our bathhouses. I can't believe they hate us this much.
Well, I've always said from the very beginning, AIDS is a political disease. But in the beginning, I have to say, and through most of it, we had a unique situation in San Francisco that other cities didn't have. One, we had a mayor who was supportive of trying to do something about this. We had a legislative body that was supportive of doing something about this. And we had a community that was supportive. Where the politics started coming in was the bathhouse issue that came up.
The bathhouse controversy was fairly intense. There was no secret that those organizations, those establishments, represented a site where people were getting infected. This was by then well known as a sexually transmitted infection. Mm-hmm. And I was unbelievably naive to think that maybe the only issue was that the bathhouse owners didn't understand the nature of AIDS. So me being me, I said, well, I'll invite them in and I'll teach them about this and then they'll do the right thing.
I guess, yeah, maybe on some level you might see it as naive, but it's this bold move that a young physician wants to reach out and work with the community.
I do think that I felt it important to bring the community in to try to work together, to try to find some way to resolve an otherwise very explosive situation.
When I realized we had the virus, we knew how it was spread, we had educated the community, then that was the time to say, okay, it is time to close it. But I didn't want to close it too early for fear that the reaction would be against the health department that was doing everything in their power to try and get a behavior change. If we were seen as the police rather than as a partner in their health care, then we'd lose the battle.
The other important piece back then was to create an environment that was going to be a healing environment and not one where patients came in and experienced rejection and shame and pain, but instead create an environment where people felt accepted, where they could come and be cared for, where they felt safe, and that they were going to have a partner, a true partner who was going to stay with them and be with them and take care of the pain that they were having, the physical pain that they were having, but also speak to the psychic pain, the emotional, spiritual issues that were going on for them. And I think that was a lot of what we did, was to try to create this environment.
I can remember an African-American patient in, this must have been somewhere around 1986, who came to Ward 86. And he was someone who could not reveal his bisexuality to his family, was married, had children, had basically a dual life that he stayed in, was not open to talking about it, talking about the dissonance that this set up in him and how that dampened his immune function because of the stress he kept himself under. And it was by no means something that I felt I could or should push.
Often these families, I mean, they didn't know their son was gay, or it was not
talked
and discussed openly. So they would discover that their son was gay, their son had AIDS, their son was gravely ill and not expected to survive, all in the same conversation. And the family members would expect to be able to advise the doctors about the level of support.
You knew the mother, you knew the father, you knew the siblings that convened. You knew the partner who was often ostracized from the decision making. That was that period when that was usually the norm. And frequently you'd have family showing up, taking over the apartment of their son, and not understanding kind of what this other guy in the apartment was about, and the tension that created all of the time of them dealing with an imminent death. It created a huge amount of psychic energy that's moving around like a ball in a, you know, a contracting room and just hitting harder and harder on the walls. So I would say that was the hardest part for all of us.
We did what now the big associations of hospitals say is the model of care, which is patient-centered care. That's what we were committed to. And when back then, patient-centered care meant that a lot of the rules of the hospital just had to go out the window, such as visiting hours. People were in, they were sick, many were dying. They needed people with them. They needed, and who they needed with them. So the laws and the rules were you had to be a father, a mother, or a legal spouse. So we threw all those rules out the window and said, patient-centered care, you the patient, you get to say who comes in your room and who gets to be with you at the moment that you're dying. And who is it that you're going to go home to, and who do we teach how to help take care of you when you go home?
One of the first patients I worked with as an intern was a guy named Gordon Panisi. And Gordon was admitted to the ICU after trying to kill himself. He was my first ICU patient. And one of the nurses on the ward made sure I got to say goodbye to him before he left. And I was so overwhelmed by this whole situation. And I went in his room, and he was thanking me for all I did for him. And I realized I was crying. But I thought, well, that's okay. He won't know till I realized that my tears were dropping on his face.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then I thought, busted. And you know, this man who was dying and blind and leaving San Francisco said, I hope things work out for you and your partner.
Yeah.
That just blew my mind. Well, then I went out into the hall, and now I'm really gushing. Dion Jones came over and took me into the room and said, you should be so proud of what you did for Gordon. And I know it's hard for you that he's going. And that was one of the best moments in my medical training, was to have a fellow health professional acknowledge my feelings and say it's okay to have feelings. I think that was one of the great things about that ward, was it was run by nurses. In fact, when people ask me about what did I like the best about my residency at San Francisco General, it was that in several places, my hospice teaching, Ward 86, the inpatient ward, my clinic, I was set up to work with nurses. And that made me a better doctor. Right. And I think it made me a better person.
So my desk used to be here, right? And you were back there.
And this was cubicles, and we used to smoke cigarettes here.
We used to go outside.
One of the things that happened early in the epidemic was the appreciation that we didn't know anything, that this was a bad situation, and we were ignorant. And the response to that was to do research and for the government to invest eventually in ramping up that research. We, as a result of that research, learned an unbelievable amount about this virus, and we made incredible strides in the control of it.
One of the interesting things was that there was a certain amount of suspicion, I think, in the HIV-infected community and their friends and family over the direction of pharmaceutical research. And there was a lot of interest in drugs that may not have been, or in devices that may not have been being developed in the standard format that you and I are interested in. And so I think about DNCB, which was used and painted on KS lesions to try to build an immune reaction against Kaposi sarcoma, and patients burned severely by those applications. Compound Q, ozone treatments, all the things went on. And it grew out of the desperation of people with HIV and their practitioners trying to do the right thing and hope for the best, not knowing where to go necessarily. Certainly, as a practitioner, I told patients repeatedly that I wanted to know what they were doing, what they were thinking about doing, and tried actually not to pass judgment unless I really thought that the treatment or device was necessarily potentially harmful.
I'm not going to let this get me. I know I'm going to beat this. I just got into a new clinical trial, and the doctors think the new set of pills will help.
AZT. Yes, AZT. Reveals new AIDS drug with probably DVC, so let's see. CD4.
I think we have some very optimistic things to talk about. We have seen the survival prolonging in patients. We've seen a more developed understanding of the nature of the disease, and I think we're at the verge, really, of having much more to talk about in terms of effective therapies. Our goal is to make this a chronic, controllable disease.
I didn't start getting sick until in 92. So I left the city and I went up to the Russian River and
sort of went there to die.
Yeah, I did go there to die, and I didn't want to die in the city with. I just wanted to be alone. And then Mark Conant called me one day and said, I want you to try some medication. It was the fall of 94, and my T cells were down to 23.
Right.
And Marcus Conant put me on a combination of low-dose AZT plus 3TC and DDC, and I bounced back like, it was just astonishing. I can remember the first day that I started that combination, and it gave me a splitting headache, and I remember thinking, oh, this isn't going to work, you know, how am I going to do this?
AZT does that.
Yeah, and the second day, the headache, but not quite so bad. And on the third or fourth day, I was living in this little tiny village of about 50 families on the Russian River, and there's one little tiny market just a short block from my house. And I think it was the fourth morning, and I woke up hungry in a good way, like,
yeah.
I want breakfast. And I put on my bathrobe and my big rubber boots because it was raining, and I walked the block and a half, that was a huge achievement, to the market, and I bought eggs and bacon and marmalade and English muffins, and went home, and my T cells in 2 or 3 weeks jumped from 23 to 320 something.
I had just diagnosed a patient with PML, and he was an ataxic, apraxic mess, and had switched to Kaiser and was going to live with his family in Sacramento. And I went by his house and had a prescription for Crixivan and Combivir, and I said, look, take this. You can't be any worse than you are, and there are people who've been really sick who've gotten better. Take this. And when you got a Kaiser, make sure they give it to you. And 2 years later, I was down the Castro having a hamburger at a restaurant, and I saw this guy eating sort of slowly, but eating, and it was him.
Yeah, yeah.
He made it. So the people who said, I'm going to beat this, well, some of them were right. It was the non-progressors, and it was the folks who lived long enough to catch the lifeboat.
To me, the maybe the most important thing is that we need to remember. We need to remember in any way possible, whether it's collecting old journal articles or having people that were there tell their memories. We need to remember this because I think we have to have learned something important going through something as horrible as this was.
We survived and it strengthened us. And there are times when I'm going to bed and trying to sleep, and suddenly it comes back to me with such clarity that I feel like I'm falling backwards off a cliff. You can talk about it for a little bit, but then those faces start to come back, and it's just unbearable. I have to stop.
Yeah.
This morning I thought you might like to know. I received your message in full a few days ago. I understood every word that it said. Now that I've actually heard it, you're going to regret. And I'm not the kind that likes to tell you just what you want me to, and you're not the kind that needs to tell me about the birds and the